For 87 years, Joseph Mitchell was an observer of the people and places around him. For 58 of those years, he wrote for the New Yorker magazine. He was more than a reporter and more than a writer. He preserved a New York that does not exist anymore for generations to come. He covered the 1936 World's Fair, and he covered McSorley's Saloon, presidential elections, and the Fulton Fish Market. He was as passionate about his interviews with average eccentrics like Joe Gould as he was about those with Eleanor Roosevelt and Noel Coward. And he presented the people he wrote about in a literary way that transcended journalism. Joining me now to reflect on a friend and irrepressible chronicler are two people who knew him. David Remnick, a writer at The New Yorker, and Roger Angell, senior editor for the magazine. I'm pleased to have them here to appreciate Joe Mitchell. We will later see an interview I did with him several years ago. I start with this New Yorker, June 10th, 1996. There's a picture down by McSorley's wonderful saloon. He always wore a hat.
That's right.
And in the winter it was felt, and in the summer it was straw.
Dashing fellow.
Tell me about him, Roger. How many years did you know him?
Well, I knew him. I can't remember when I first met him because I wrote for the New Yorker long before I went to work there. I went to work there in 56, and I knew him then. I used to see him at Costello's, the old bar on 3rd Avenue. But he was there every day after I came there in September of 56.
Now, they say he would, and I got this out. You, David, put together these pieces and people remembering.
Well, I wrote the introduction,
yeah, right.
And then a bunch of staff writers
right.
contributed some pieces.
He would come into the office and shut the door and write away. And then at lunch, put his hat
back on, go out for lunch,
go to the
Grand Central Oyster Bar or someplace like that, or wherever he went, and come back and then put in an afternoon and then come in and go home.
Before we talk about the character, what about the writer? What was it about him?
Well, I think he influenced almost everybody who wrote at the New Yorker afterward. It's a terrible thing to say. It's become familiar. He wrote with a marvelous simplicity, nothing ornate, always the right word. I looked over this afternoon. I looked over the introduction that he wrote up in the old hotel. His last collection that did so well, it came out in 1992, and there's a sentence in there about being down home in North Carolina and getting ready for a picnic and picking some watermelons. It's a very short sentence. It isn't even a sentence. It's not a complete sentence. And in that, he uses the surprising word, they said that we pulled the watermelons instead of picked them. Yeah. He describes two different kinds of watermelons, the rattlesnake something and the Cuban something. I'm sorry, I've forgotten the two. He uses the word heavy twice. He uses the word green twice in a very short sentence. Breaks all the rules. And yet this is the way some of us yearned to write after he had done this. It looked so easy.
Yeah. David, what was it about him?
Well, I came to the New Yorker two or three years after Roger. And,
I'd say.
And as unfortunately,
plus a zero.
Unfortunately, what most people tend to know about Joe Mitchell first is that for the last 30-odd years of his life, he did not publish in The New Yorker. His last piece for The New Yorker was Joe Gould's Secret, probably his masterpiece. In 1964, that was published, and that was it. That's all we heard. And there were always rumors that he was writing something else, whether it was about the Fulton Fish Market again or an autobiographical piece. He told one interviewer that he was writing something about a lady around town that I know. God knows what he was doing, but certainly he was writing, and certainly he was not pleased or did not find charming the whole business of not publishing, although some might have made a kind of myth of it or an aesthetic of it. I think he probably suffered a great deal about it. It didn't make him happy. I just enjoyed it and wrote like crazy, probably wrote too much and on and on and on until he finally expired from too much living and pleasure almost. Mitchell was the opposite in a way. His prose was extremely considered and quicksilver and nothing wasted. He, of course, didn't write too much. And there were two opposite examples, but you could learn a hell of a lot by listening to both.
And there was a time here in the city where he was on the side of the trucks. I mean, Joe Mitchell's stories,
Maybe. When he was a newspaper man, yeah.
Were eagerly awaited, right. Whether he was covering something, you want to see what.
That's right. By the time he came to The New Yorker, he was a feature writer that everybody knew about.
Wrote some of the best profiles around.
That's right, yeah.
The competition between Mitchell and Liebling.
Well, I think there was competition between a lot of writers in those days, as there is maybe now. But Joe Liebling and Joe Mitchell were pals, and there was heated competition and about who was the better writer. They never said that, but that's what it was really about. And who was the quicker writer? Liebling was the quicker writer. And
that was one hands down.
And what used to drive Liebling crazy is that Mitchell knew so much. He knew everything. There was nothing he didn't know. And Liebling was a brooder. And he was off one day at lunchtime, off on the west side by himself, walking around. And he went into this little taxidermy shop. I remember this place. I've been in there myself. He was looking around among the dusty owls. And in there, not thinking of anything. And he found this little tiny assemblage of white bones all connected in some way, sitting on a shelf. And he called the proprietor over and says, "What is this?" And he said, and the proprietor says, "Well," he said, "the male armadillo, as you can imagine, has a very hard time breeding."
Breeding.
And breeding, the sexual act for the armadillos is not easy. And this is part of what male armadillos have inside, and it helps them. So it's a wonderful thing, almost unique in nature. So Liebling buys this thing for about $10, this little thing, and puts it in a paper bag, and he goes back to the office, takes it out of the paper bag, and he goes, looks in, see where Mitchell is. Mitchell is typing like this, slowly, and Liebling comes in, without a word, he puts it down on the desk next to him, and Mitchell pauses like this, and he says, "Oh," he said, "Peter Bone of the male armadillo. Do you have any questions about this, Joe?"
With that, Liebling fled the room.
That's right. That was the
said,
end of that.
He's got me one more time.
That's right, yeah. But, of course, Mitchell was a country boy, so he would know that.
I mean, yeah. Yeah. Maybe that's how the term boner began.
Yeah.
His writing, what was he doing in all those hours?
Oh, during the long silence?
Yeah.
I don't know. I don't think anybody
knows. Did I don't he talk to anybody about it?
He must have talked to somebody. He never talked to me about it, and he didn't talk to, I mean, I never heard it explained. I mean, there was, as David has said, there was about this, there was something about the harbor. At one point, he was doing something about the seaport.
He loved the water.
He knew all about it, and it was one of his subjects. But he was silent. There was a long, long, long silence.
He had some important personal losses in his life, and I think that hurt a lot. But, you know, one of his closest friends outside the New Yorker, and there were a lot of them, and they ranged high and low, was Ralph Ellison. Mm. And they shared this this silence, which I think pained them both. It turns out now that Ralph Ellison certainly did write the bulk of what constitutes a second novel. It's now in the hands of an academic who, God willing, will turn it into a discernible Ralph Ellison novel. We know a little bit about it. It's been published in various journals. And who knows, that might be the case with Joe Mitchell, but always in these projects, these posthumous projects, something is going to be missing, like with Hemingway's Garden of Eden, which was cobbled together by an editor. But you know, we have Up in the Old Hotel, it's 600 odd pages long, it's enough. You know, yeah. It's said of poets that poets practice a lifetime so that they can stand out in rainstorms all their life and get hit by lightning 10 or 15 times. It happened to Joe Mitchell 10 or 15 times, and we're the richer for it. So if there's more, great. And if there's not, we've got what we've got.
Yeah, I mean, that's an interesting subject. We have talked on this program with other people about it, and I've had very good actors. When I say, "Why haven't you been that good more often?" And they often look at me with some sense of, "What are you asking for in one lifetime?"
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, that I find a part, that I find the right script, that I find a time, that it all comes together, you know, to understand that process.
I don't know. I think that Joe may have suffered from the fact that he had been noticed and somewhat lionized and overpraised. And what he was overpraised for was for being artless, for writing prose that was so simple and effortless and yet so marvelous. And I don't think he took those things seriously, but I think once those were in his mind, perhaps, I'm just guessing, I have no idea, he may have looked at what he did and said, is it good enough? I think every writer who's written anything and has any kind of a record when you write something, you think, is this good enough? Is it good enough for me? Is it good? Is it good? You know, and the cross is at the back of your mind, is as good as what I've done before. And it's possible, since every writer does think of that terrible moment when you're going to dry up, that this is one of the contributing factors. But I don't think anybody at The New Yorker knows. I really don't. I never heard anybody say, I know
Philip,
why, Joe.
Philip never said.
I don't think anybody's ever heard or knows for a certainty what it was. Mm.
Take a look at this. This is an interview that I did with Joe Mitchell September 17th, 1992, almost 4 years ago. Here it is, and you capture some of who he was and what he was and how he was. Roll tape.
Yeah. But I come from a little town, and...
Fairmont, North Carolina.
That's right. And I grew up knowing odd people.
What fascinates you about, I mean, when you say odd people, what are you talking about?
Well, my father, well, my family's been down there since before the Revolutionary War in this little swamp country in North Carolina. And it's going through all kinds of, my family started out, they were turpentine distillers, they distilled turpentine and tar and pitch. That they sent down, we'd take it up to Fayetteville, they would take it up to Fayetteville,
right.
Put it on a boat, take it down to Wilmington, and right. We'd go to England. And then my father, he got into the cotton business.
Right.
Well, he's a farmer, but he went into town and got it. You know what a cotton buyer is?
Yeah.
Well, they were a...
My father used to have a cotton gin.
Well, cotton, you see, down there, that's something that's going out of the world, God, I hesitate to use such a word. The romance of a cotton gin.
Yeah.
In fall, when the farmers are bringing that cotton there. Yeah.
But you left all that. One, because you couldn't count. You couldn't count.
You
and so, oh, well, I know. So
that's
you,
the truth.
Because you couldn't keep up with the numbers. And so you come to New York at 21 years old, right?
The multiplication table got me where I am. Excuse me.
And what did you love? What did you love about these characters? You found the most interesting characters, and there are some people, a lot of people who have been part of The New Yorker will say that no one who ever wrote for The New Yorker wrote any better than Joe Mitchell.
Well, you know how those superlatives are. But
yes,
but,
that's right, I do.
But really, you know, looking back, a small town is supposed to be so dull, and God knows, but there was a man down there that had a great deal to do with my education, with practical things. His name was Alonzo McNair.
Right.
And my father was a gambler. He was a speculator. He speculated on futures in the New York Cotton Exchange.
Right.
Little old depot down there, just a little old tell it one thing. And
I've seen hundreds of them.
I know it. Yeah. He's in contact with Hubbard Brothers, a big brokers firm up in New York, and he makes a little and sometimes does very well. We came up here one time, and there was a man in the in this brokerage firm who told my father, he said, look, I think you came from Alabama. He said, you look around the depot there, is there some old men sitting around there that lost all their money in the New York Cotton Exchange? And my father said, yes. And my father had an idea that this young man, he looked at me, he said, you think, my father had been doing very well.
Yeah.
You know, he was coming up, he was going to widen his act. So this man said, you think it's your judgment. It's just luck.
There he is. Is that the man you knew and liked?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Can you do this thing, Roger?
But I was thought when he was talking that he was like Casey Stengel in a way. He didn't talk like Casey Stengel, but Casey always had 1,000 references he wanted to make in the same sentence. And Joe was always reaching for another connection and a connection. This reminds me of something else. So, and his hands began to go like this. But you know, the
shows you're talking has nothing to do with writing.
No,
it's the absolute opposite of the way he put words on paper.
Exactly.
The discipline is
sparse, precise,
and discipline.
Discipline.
Yeah.
The thing about Joe that we've talked about his writing, we've seen him talking. I think the key to him, the most amazing thing about him, he was a great, great listener. This is why he was such a wonderful reporter. all his reporting. In the end, he finds people who can talk. He goes to places, finds people he knows nothing about, and he lets them talk. And that wonderful piece of his, The Bottom of the Harbor, maybe I think it's my favorite of all his pieces, he finds some rivermen in different places, and he lets them talk, and they talk, and they talk, and they talk. And it ends with a black bricklayer who lives in a place called Sandy Ground, a little south Staten Island seaport, a little hamlet for blacks, talking about his past, talking about his relatives who were on old oyster sloops, and then walking in the graveyard and talking about everybody in, and this just goes on page after page. And in the end, he stands, Mr. Hunter, his name was, stands by the grave of his first wife, and he says, she was a little woman. She had a low voice. She had the prettiest hands. She said she wore a size 5.5 glove. I mean, this is reporting. Just wait. And you know, I tell myself, whenever I go to a story, remember to listen. Remember to listen. It's the number one thing. And I don't think we do it as well as we used to. But mm-hmm. I really did. He was the great listener of our time.
You know, invariably, when you hear, if you tape yourself interviewing someone, invariably you want to kill yourself for having interjected too much.
That's
and
right.
Talked too much. And also, the demands of modern journalism are such very often that you go, you have 45 minutes in the hotel room with star X, and you know, the publicist is there, and the whole scene, you know, that either the public knows about or doesn't know about. And Mitchell, for example, in Joe Gould's Secret, this is somebody he knew for years and years, and would go down to diners and bars downtown and just listen to this guy, who was fundamentally crazy, rattle on and on and on and on and spin out his story until he got the gold dust. But he didn't sit there assuming that the gold dust would come that night. He spent the time.
That's right.
And that's part of what took so much time in his pieces.
Thank you both. It's a pleasure to have you here. And remember, a fellow North Carolinian, there are stories about Joe Mitchell in the June 10th, 1996 edition of The New Yorker on your newsstand now. Calvin Trillin said, I once dedicated a book to Joe Mitchell as the New Yorker reporter who set the standard. He was that to me and to a number of nonfiction writers I knew inside and outside the magazine during decades when most literate Americans might have had trouble placing his name. Philip Hamburger said, Joe Mitchell and I were close friends for some 6 decades. When I heard that he was gone, I comforted myself by dipping into his work. There they are, the stray phrases lodged forever somewhere in the subconscious. From Lady Olga, the bearded lady, quote, if the truth were known, we're all freaks together. From Almost a Flood, I love a hearty eater, but I do despise a gourmet. Joe Mitchell, thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for joining us. We'll see you tomorrow night.